a breakout at the workplace. I'm not sure I understand what the alternative would be. You're right. There would be claims paid out if the cases are proven in comp court. And, of course, it's very likely that the premiums would go up. But I'm trying to find out from you, what do you say, because you're in the field, what would you say the alternative to that would be?
I don't know what the alternative is. I'm just bringing it up for a point of discussion because, you know, if the rates and the insurance, if you're an employer and your insurance rates go way up, I mean, that can be a big dollar amount. So
you're absolutely right.
All right, go ahead, Richard.
Yes, you're absolutely right, Rich. It could be a big problem for employers, but that is the cost of doing business. When there are claims made and the claims are viable, that have to be paid out.
Let's talk about what Rich brought up here as well, how ironclad are insurance policies in which some CEO tells his board of directors, hey, we're covered, don't worry about it. I got an insurance policy.
You know, this is very interesting because there's a lot of fights going on right now with companies and insurance companies regarding pandemic exclusions and whether they're going to hold up. Now, in workers' comp, that doesn't seem to be an issue, at least at this point. It seems that because that is a work-related disease, if you can prove it happened in the workplace. But there are other issues out there that is litigation has already started between insurance companies and regular companies. Good question.
Yeah, absolutely. And more to come at 1-866-50-JIMBO, 1-866-505-4626. Richard Bell, our guest. He is a civil rights attorney based in New York. And I'm curious also about any notable cases that have come up in the news of late. We mentioned the McDonald's workers. Are there others?
Well, you know, interestingly enough, you know, as of a few months ago, in mid-May, the Insurance Journal reported there were only 45 of these personal injury cases resulting from COVID, and more than half of them were on cruise ships. So cruise ships, nursing homes, because those are confined areas where it's much easier to prove the causation part, that it was caused by negligence at the premises or on that ship. So right now, no, and I don't see it in my practice, and my colleagues don't either, because I think the biggest hurdle is about proving that you got it from a particular place.
To KC in Cascade, Montana now. Hi.
Yeah, I have a question about the lawyers proving the scientific viability and truthfulness of some of these standards, like the 6-foot distancing and the masks and the what's the other one? You know, the very standard things that they're putting out.
Yeah.
How can you sue somebody if those are not really solidified in the scientific arena?
Sure.
Okay, I would argue that they are. They're the guidelines of the CDC. They're the guidelines of departments of health. They're the guidelines of state laws. And I don't think that's going to be an issue where there's going to be a big fight over. I don't foresee that.
All right. Very good. And more to come. Stay with us as we look at all kinds of cans of worms that can be reopened just by the simple act of going back to work. And, of course, again, when we're talking about something like this, it's very difficult to prove where you got something. 1-866-50-JIMBO is our number, 1-866-505-4626, civil rights attorney Richard Bell, our guest, and we'll take a look at the whole notion of how much legal protection you have when you go back on the job. Back with more in a moment. Welcome back to the Jim Bohannon Show at 1-866-50-JIMBO, 1-866-505-4626. Attorney Richard Bell, our guest, and we're looking at the kinds of protection that you have available, really, on the job in general. We often hear complaints made about things put out by OSHA, for example, like warning signs, you know, be sure not to step on ice and try to dance the tango, this sort of thing. Some of the rules that we see that sometimes have to be literally posted at a work site strike us as rather obvious. I'm wondering your thoughts about OSHA rules and the extent to which you're covered if you've put up all the signs at your place of employment. You're the owner of the company, and you've got all your little OSHA signs posted everywhere, even the perfectly obvious things. Does that at all protect you from liability? Because you warned them.
Gotcha. So OSHA, essentially the rule of OSHA says that a workplace has to be free from recognized hazards likely to cause death or serious harm. That's exactly what the law says in OSHA. And like I said, you can't sue your employer. This all goes into the workers' comp system. So let's bring it to where we are with COVID, because this is a little bit different now. OSHA is not taking a big role here at all. But I would say that right now, the states, of course, have. And I would say right now, probably the gold standard would be what New York is doing. So we're finally getting into the third phase, and a lot of places are back to work at some level. And what the state has done is they have required every business to have a COVID safety plan for their workplace. And they even give you a little template on their website, and you don't have to file it with the state. You just have to have one if they ever inspected you, and they make you submit an affirmation to the state that you did read the gut health guidelines and you're obligated to comply. So now we're way beyond signs, because, you know, this is a pandemic that's very clear. And there's a lot of mandatory guidelines when you go back to work here, as things about social distancing and free masks and screenings and questionnaires and limited gatherings. So we have a whole system here of how to get back to work, but to get back as safely as possible. So I think OSHA is going to play a much lesser role these days. I think the states are going to be playing the bigger role right now.
I'm wondering about some of these standards, the 6-foot distancing, the wearing of masks and so on and so forth, washing of hands and the like. If you catch the COVID-19 virus at work and it can be shown, maybe with video, I don't know, but whatever, it can be shown that you are violating all of that. Do you have a leg to stand on by complaining that you caught the virus at work when you're not wearing a mask and you're not washing your hands and the like?
Well, under the workers' comp law, it's usually not a fault standard. It's usually a standard of you were injured at work. You know, you gave the example of drunk before that. It might fall into a different category. But in the usual workers' comp sector, it's enough that you caught it. Unless you intentionally brought it upon yourself, that could be a different story.
All right. As you go about your work, in regard to such cases involving damages sought from an employer, what is a typical case? The majority of cases, let's say, what do you hear the most?
Okay, so when it's an employer, like I said, it's not a direct lawsuit. It wouldn't go into the regular trial court system in any of the states. It would go into the workers' comp system. Very different system. You have an administrative judge. You basically have to show I was doing my work, I caught a disease or I was injured, and I have certain damages. And those are the basic things you have to show. Like you were saying earlier, you know, there's lots of different circumstances that can arise where you were doing something negligent that's not going to be a problem in getting your workers' comp. Even if you were doing something negligent, the standard is you did get hurt at work and you're not allowed to sue your employer. See, if you were allowed to sue your employer, then they could raise a defense that you were negligent comparatively. But in the comp system, it's different because, number one, they've taken away your right to sue them, and number two, the kind of compensation you get in compensation court is very little compared to a regular personal injury lawsuit if there were serious injuries.
I have heard supposed horror stories about the workers' compensation system. And of course, in this day and age, with some of the tripe that makes it online, you never know whether these are true or not. There's a story making the rounds of a person who received workers' compensation when he had a part of his ear bitten off. So the story goes that the ear was bitten off by the woman he was raping at the time. And I'm just wondering whether or not that's apocryphal or not. Do your experience, how fair and how laden with common sense is the workers' compensation system?
I would say it's only as good as the judge you get before. And that varies by within a state, within a city, within a county. It really is a judge-based system because in workers' comp, when it gets appealed, the judge's fact findings, because there's no jury, it's a judge, they are rarely questioned. So it's only as good as the judges that are appointed to those positions, and they vary. Well, I don't know the story you just said, which seems absolutely absurd, but there are some terrible stories out there. You're not wrong. There is what seems like abuse. There's what seems like insane decisions. I would agree with you on that.
All right, more to come. Stay with us. 1-866-50-JIMBO, 1-866-505-4626. When you finally get back to work, this is probably the last thing you're thinking about, or you might be wondering, gee, I wonder if I could pick up the virus at work. But in general, for many people, we'd be so glad to get back and get a paycheck and back in familiar surroundings that this may not occur to you. Well, it's better to occur to you now, and so you're prepared for it than to blunder into it. 1-866-50-JIMBO, 1-866-505-4626 on the Jim Bohannon Show with Richard Bell, civil rights attorney. Back in a moment. Welcome back to the Jim Bohannon Show at 1-866-50-JIMBO, 1-866-505-4626, as we talk with attorney Richard Bell about some of the things you need to consider in terms of your workplace. Would you have advice to people in general when they're looking for work? And of course, people look for all kinds of things in work. They look for pay and benefits and working conditions and the like, but probably the suitability of filing a lawsuit isn't first on their list, and it shouldn't be, I don't suppose, but at least it's something that needs to be kept in mind, right?
Yes, I think what you need, obviously everything you mentioned are priorities. I think what you always need to look at in any workplace you're potentially going into is, how does it look to you, and how do the people that are there look to you in terms of safety? Does it look like things are being done in a safe manner, in a healthy manner? Because that is the number one test. And obviously, we're in a pandemic, so it's all that more important.
All right. These are just considerations that I think most of us probably don't keep in mind as we go about this sort of thing. In terms of most state laws, regulations, and the like, what changes should we make? Are there areas in which we're deficient or overly protective or not protective enough?
Well, you know what I think? I think we all have to stand back a second because of the era that we're in and just say, hey, boy, is safety and health important in a workplace. We kind of take it for granted. And you say to yourself, well, you know, I'm sure it's being taken care of. It's not always being taken care of. So I think what we need to do is to make sure that we have the kinds of state rules and regulations and public health laws in effect and the right kind of personnel to run proper inspections to make sure everybody's playing by the rules.
Yeah. Fair enough. And that, of course, it gets into another area. And that, of course, involves money to hire inspectors and people who know what they're doing and this sort of thing. And my guess would be that whatever we have currently is substandard, at least in terms of the amount of people involved.